Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have Dr. S.J. Olshansky here. He is the co-founder and chief scientist at Lapidus Solutions. You've probably seen his work published in the Wall Street Journal or seen him interviewed on 60 Minutes with Morley Safer. He is a really interesting guy. We're going to talk about how long we're going to live and how to extend our lives. Great research. Stay tuned. We'll be back right after this.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Dr. S.J. Olshansky, who is a professor of epidemiology and biostatistics at the University of Illinois at Chicago School of Public Health. He's also chief scientist at Lapidus Solutions and board member of the American Federation of Aging Research. It's so nice to have you here, Jay.
Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure.
Oh, well, this is fun. I saw one of your articles in the Wall Street Journal about whether we're going to live past 100. I think the first question was, is the first person who will live to 150 alive today? And was fascinated by that. As you know, a little background. I mean, I worked in pharmaceuticals and I have some medical education from going through that. But I think it's really a fascinating topic in the midst of all that we're going through with COVID and health and research. And since I'm interested in curiosity, I want to find out more about you and what got you so interested in this, because I did watch the 60 Minutes piece on you, and a lot of the stuff that you're talking about is going to fascinate a lot of people. So why don't you give us a little bit of background?
Well, I thought you were going to ask me about what the secret was to living to 150.
Oh, I will. I got to figure out what the secret was of you getting this long, though, first.
Yeah, no, exactly. So, no, actually, that particular story is an interesting one because there's stories that come out every year, usually Time Magazine, but a bunch of different magazines talk about aging and longevity, and there's a lot of exaggeration in our field. And it was about 20 years ago that an exaggerated story came out about somebody living to 150. This was actually picked up on by some insurance companies like Prudential. That made claims that the first 150-year-old person is here, so you better plan accordingly. And I'm shaking my head, thinking to myself, come on, this is ridiculous. You know, the oldest lived person in history was 122. And so to make it to 150, you'd have to break this record by 28 years, and it's a really difficult record to break. And when I saw the story that included a quote from my colleague that he thought somebody would actually live that long, and my colleague is a well-respected scientist in the field of aging, Dr. Steve Austad, and I said, come on, you can't really believe that. He goes, well, I actually think it's possible that one person might make it. So that's what ended up in turning into this bet. It's called the $1 billion wager. I don't know if you've seen it, but
it's one of the more famous bets. Yeah.
Uh-huh. It's one of the more famous bets in science today, and it ended up leading to the creation of a website called Long Bets by Wired Magazine, where there's similar bets like this. But the bet was fairly straightforward. Will anybody alive in the year 2000 be alive in the year 2150? And we put enough money down so that with compound interest, it'll be worth about $1 billion in 2150. I said, no, it's not going to happen. And Steve said, yes, it was. And it sort of morphed into this story in the Wall Street Journal, you know, is 100 the new norm for life expectancy, which is a little more reasonable than 150, but not by much. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the bottom line is that human longevity, no question, has been rising very rapidly throughout most of the 20th century. It's slowed down, as expected, in the last 15, 20 years. And then the real question is, how much higher can it go? Now, the reason why it can't go extremely high is the same reason why you can't run a 3-minute mile or, you know, jump 10 feet. It's because these bodies weren't really made to last that long or run that fast or throw that high or jump that high. So it's just not even biologically possible in these bodies. And that's sort of a debate that's going on now. And that ultimately answers your question, how did I get into this? It's, you know, why do we live as long as we do? And that's a question that we actually know the answer to. It's not, you know, there's a reason why we don't live as long as whales, which live 210 years, or Greenland sharks, which can live for over 500 years, or a mouse that lives for 3 years. There are reasons why we live as long as we do.
Why aren't we pregnant as long as elephants? I'm glad for that one, I guess, huh?
You want that?
No.
But actually, it's funny that you would ask that question, because as it turns out, duration of life of a species is calibrated to reproduction. So this idea of when a species goes through puberty and menopause, when reproduction begins and ends, that ultimately is the determining factor for why animals, including humans, live as long as we do. It's a genetically fixed program for growth and development, and aging is pretty much an accidental byproduct of that. And so, you know, it's funny that you would have mentioned, you know, reproduction, because that's the driving force.
Wow, I did not know that. And I think it's, well, I would like to just bring back attention just a little bit to the 60 Minutes piece, because what was that, 2005, when they interviewed you, when Morley yes. Safer interviewed you? And they were also interviewing Dr. Aubrey de Grey, right?
Yes.
Okay, so his point was you could live in the thousands eventually, and you were saying, yeah, no. Okay, so whatever happened with what predictions he said versus what you said, in 15 years have gone by, and I'm just curious how that debate's changed or if it's the same.
Well, of course, what's changed is we're all 15 years older, and a lot of the people that believe that are now dead. You know, I've got a book I published a chapter in a book not long ago entitled Why Do Anti-Aging Doctors Die? Because this claim that we can live forever, we can live for 1,000 years, isn't new. Mm-hmm. It comes from, you know, a field that's called anti-aging medicine. It's been called various things for the last 2,000-3,000 years. And the claim has always been the same. We're on the verge of some great breakthrough that's going to make us live for 1,000 years. I mean, the origin of chemistry, modern chemistry, originated with alchemy. Remember, alchemy was the effort to transmute lead into gold, and gold was sought after because kings wanted to drink out of gold cups, not because it was cool to do so, but because they thought that they could consume minute quantities of the gold, which would give them the properties of immortality that gold had. So it was... You know, and I've called this industry that's selling these kinds of products and this line of reasoning as the second oldest profession. We all know what the first oldest profession is. The second oldest profession. So basically, nothing has changed. Aubrey, there's no more chance of living to 1,000 today than there was 15 years ago. It's pure hype. It's great. It makes good headlines for newspapers and radio programs, and it's great for interviews when somebody comes on and says, yeah, we're going to live to 1,000. But not in these bodies, it's not going to happen. So, no.
Well, you know what's interesting to me is it doesn't seem likely to me either, but sometimes you don't know what you don't know. I mean, in the past, what we had the humors and all the, was it the four humors or whatever that they looked at, and that was everything. And then everything changes through time of what we learn from big breakthroughs. I can remember listening to a Neil deGrasse Tyson book where they were talking, very famous physicists would say, you know, we've learned everything we know we could ever learn about, you know, physics. And then, you know, of course, they have no idea what everything is now, that there's still this black matter, dark matter, and, you know, all these things that no one can explain. So do you think that there's a possibility that there's a big piece of this puzzle that we're missing, that we, if yeah, we're so, curious, you know, I mean, how can we?
Yeah, that's a great question. And mm-hmm. that's actually what Aubrey would say. Aubrey, uh-huh. if he was part of this, he would go, look, Jay, if we were, you know, over 100 years ago and you asked the question, could we ever fly? You know, that's ridiculous. That'll never happen. And here we are flying into space. So, yeah, so you're basically asking that question. Is there something that we don't know about the human body that might lead us to live to 1,000 years? Well, you know, look, I don't rule anything out. I'm not saying that there's a 0% probability that right. there's something we don't know that could allow us to live to 1,000. And let me point out, by the way, that Aubrey and I and a whole large group of scientists in the field of aging now believe that we are on the verge of a breakthrough that is going to allow us to slow the biological process. And the reason why we know this is possible is because it's already been done. It's been done for other species. And even within humans, there are people alive today that make it past the century mark. They're called centenarians. And people that make it past 110, they're called supercentenarians. And we think they can live that long because their bodies are basically ticking at a slower rate. Their mm-hmm. biological clock is ticking at a slower rate. And we think that we can manipulate this clock and allow us to extend the period of healthy life. Now, the research scientists that are in the field aren't trying to manipulate this clock for the purpose of making us live longer, although I think that that will be one of the secondary effects. The primary purpose of slowing aging is to extend the period of healthy life. Life extension without health extension is a disaster.
Right.
And we don't want that. Nobody wants that. So we're going after this approach to extend the period of healthy life. Will it allow us to live to 1,000? There's no evidence to suggest that that is plausible. We might live a few years longer, but 1,000 years is just made up out of thin air. And, you know, keep in mind, we have body parts that aren't replicating. You know, there are parts that do replicate, where you have cell division, and, you know, the blood is constantly replenishing itself, and the skin and other body parts, but the brain does not replenish, muscles do not replenish, and so eventually you run out of muscle mass. Eventually you run out of brain matter, and until we can influence the aging of muscle and the aging of the brain, and maybe we will be able to do that at some time in the future, we have an Achilles heel. And in our existing bodies, we simply cannot push out the envelope of survival much beyond where we are today. And I think we actually shouldn't even be trying to overcome those limitations, because we may not like what we see if we succeed in any way in extending life without extending health. So,
you know, you bring up an interesting point, because, I mean, in my family, most people have died from heart disease, and I'd certainly rather die of that than cancer. Personal preference, just because of the suffering involved. And, you know, is it worth living an extra 5 years if you're going to be suffering, taking chemotherapy and whatever to get through the extra age that it gives? So that's a very tough thing. But it also reminds me of the old Star Trek, where they didn't get sick and they're trying to get infected because of overpopulation. You've got Social Security, you've got all these things that are, you know, financial things to consider. And nobody seems to be really proactive with preparing for this extra lifespan in terms of that part. And if we're still, you know, not wanting to hire people up over 50 and all the things that we see in the workplace, what happens to everybody who's living this long?
Yeah, so that's a great question as well. So as it turns out, there is another company that has formed called WealthSpan Financial Group. And this particular group of advisors are acutely aware of these issues associated with lifespan and health span. And in fact, they've partnered with Lapidus. That's how I know about what they're doing. And they realize that people don't know about their own longevity. They don't know about their own health span. And when you go into a financial advisor, you know, your advisor might plan for a projected lifespan of 90 or 95. They make the numbers out of thin air because they don't know. And so what these companies are doing, like WealthSpan and like Lapidus, is They're providing a science-based estimate of lifespan for an individual and health span, healthy life expectancy for an individual that can be used for financial planning purposes. So you're absolutely right. Under current conditions, most people aren't really acutely aware of how long they're likely to live and what their planning should be for their future. And once you learn about this, it actually will help individuals make better decisions about planning for the future. It will provide some guidance to Social Security. The Social Security Administration, for example, you know, I've served on their advisory board for the Social Security Administration, and they are now acutely aware of what the potential implications are if we succeed in slowing aging. Now, keep in mind, if we successfully slow aging and extend the period of healthy life, in a way, it's good for Social Security because people will probably remain in the labor force for a longer time period. They will continue to contribute to Social Security for a longer time period. The proper interpretation when we succeed, by the way, is that it'll take 70 years to become 50. It'll take 80 years to become 60. So, you know, your biological clock will tick at a slower rate. You will feel younger for a longer time period, and a lot of people are probably going to remain in the labor force longer. So life extension is not necessarily going to be harmful to a program like Social Security. You know, a lot depends on when people start drawing from Social Security. Mm-hmm. But, it's not a bad thing. I mean, look, the alternative is an extension of unhealthy life. And I can't think of a worse scenario than that. And keep in mind that one way in which the extension of unhealthy life might occur is if we cure some of the major fatal diseases today. So you said you'd rather die from cancer or from cardiovascular disease than cancer. Well, look, if we cure cancer, life expectancy for the population rises about 3.5 years only. That's all. A little bit more for cardiovascular disease. Why isn't it much more than that? Because there's an underlying biological process of aging that's operating beneath the surface that's leading to many of these diseases and disorders. So there are trade-offs that are occurring at later ages. When one thing goes down, something else goes up. It's a big game of whack-a-mole. And that's where we're at today. And we have to be careful because we may not like the moles that come up when something else goes down. And the projection that many of us have is Alzheimer's disease might be the one thing that we see with much greater frequency in the future if we succeed in reducing cancer and heart disease today.
I wish I could think of the movie that, is it Final Destination, where they were all supposed to die, but they didn't, so that they have to die this really horrible way because they didn't die the first time. And that's what it's bringing to mind. But as you're talking about this, first of all, I want to know what the company said. Do you know how long you're going to live? Did they do your prediction for you?
For me, yes. Actually, not only was the prediction done for me using the conventional way, but there's also a genetic test called the Genarian Longevity Panel, which we've developed at Lapidus. It's going to be used by WellSpan. And I'm a carrier of two genes. One's called the FOXO3 gene, and one's called the APOE E2E2 genetic variant, both of which are associated with a very long, healthy life. Now, as it turns out, my father lived to 96, my mother to 90. My sister is doing very well at 69. She went through menopause very late, which is associated with exceptional longevity. So, yeah, the prediction for me is at least the mid-90s.
Wow. And that's healthy mid-90s, right? Not
most of it, hopefully, most of it will be healthy. And I can tell you that last year, my colleagues and I published a paper on the projected health and longevity of all of the presidential candidates in the upcoming election. At the time, I think there were like 27. Of course, we're now down to two. So later on this summer, we are going to publish a follow-up to that on the projected health and longevity of both Joe Biden and President Trump.
Can you tell us anything as a sneak peek now?
No, I cannot. I do have a pretty good idea of what it's going to be, but I don't want to.
Okay, I understand.
I don't want to scoop myself.
How about former presidents? Like, who's still alive? Bush or...
Bush or Obama.
Obama?
Clinton. Yeah, so I was the first scientist to publish an article in a medical journal on the projected longevity of the observed and projected longevity of all of the U.S. presidents. This came out in Journal of the American Medical Association a few years ago, and I basically documented the fact that presidents live significantly longer than average. And this was counterintuitive because some people believed erroneously that presidents would die early because of the stress associated with being president. And of course, they see pictures of the president going into the presidency and coming out, and they look a whole lot different.
Right.
And I said, look, if you take a picture of anybody 8 years apart, they're going to look a lot different.
Right.
Especially when you get up into your 50s and 60s. So, and since we don't die from graying hair, it's probably not that much of an issue. And I'm pretty sure the presidents thrive for the most part on the added stress associated with the presidency. So they actually tend to live significantly longer. Part of that has to do with high education, high income, access to health care, the very things that make some other subgroups of the population live very long as well. No surprise there.
Well, when you talk about thriving on added stress and, you know, slowing the clock down, I'm talking about, I'm not sure if I'm thinking, if we're talking about hyperactivity, how our metabolism, any of that, is that part of the equation? If you're slowing the clock down, as somebody like me who works at high speed type A, got a fast moving clock already, or is that have any part of the equation at all?
Yeah, I don't think you're going to transform a type A into a non-type A by slowing aging. All you're going to do is you're going to take the biological processes that are occurring in the body that are either causing damage or associated with the repair of that damage, and you're going to improve that whole process. That basically means a type A can continue being a type A for a longer time period in a state of good health. It's not going to transform a type A into something else.
Well, I'm curious what you do at Lapidus. I mean, we've mentioned it, but can you, other than what we've already said, who comes to work with you? What do you study? And I know you've written books. I mean, you have some great books, The Quest for Immortality, A Measured Breath of Life. You were the co-editor of Aging, The Longevity Demand. There's a lot. I'm looking at the list. You have a lot of books that you've written, but what do you do exactly at Lapidus?
Well, so the reason why this is an interesting question, because it relates to why Lapidus came into existence. I'm a research scientist in the field of aging, and my focus is on estimating how long humans can live. So I've been writing on this topic for the better part of 36 years now. And I was invited to give a talk at an insurance company called AIG. I don't know if you, Bob Benmosche was the CEO at the time. And at the time, when I gave a talk at their organization, I was explaining why we live as long as we do. And he was shocked by some of the information that came from there. And part of it was the observation that people who look young for their age are probably aging at a slower rate. In other words, the face seems to be a window into the rate at which the aging of the body is occurring.
That's interesting.
And so what I set out to do was to find a way to measure this scientifically. So I went in search of a scientist that is capable of measuring face age, and I found him. His name is Dr. Carl Riksenick from the University of North Carolina at Wilmington. He invented the field of facial analytics, and the two of us came together to create this company. And the only reason why we created the company was because a story appeared in the Washington Post in 2014, I think it was, about the research that we were doing and trying to measure face age as a biomarker for the rate of aging. And we were inundated by investors that wanted to buy into whatever company we were creating. And I basically said, we don't have one. And they said, well, you ought to create one because you just disrupted several industries all at once, including wealth management, life insurance, health insurance,
right, and so
forth. You know, so that's what. And then we had somebody throwing money at us. We ended up taking an investment of millions of dollars to create Lapidus, and we are basically on a daily basis trying to get insurance and reinsurance companies and wealth management companies to begin using the science of aging to help them better advise clients, to better underwrite people for life insurance, basically to remove all the friction associated with life insurance underwriting, to help financial advisors sell life insurance more efficiently. You know, there's no need for blood and urine to be taken anymore during all of
That's
these processes. There's lots of ways in which you can do these assessments remotely using your cell phone. And in fact, the rise of COVID has accelerated the interest in this technology. So basically, Lapidus and WellSpan, we're all focused on providing information remotely through your cell phone or your computer, and that all of these other processes that need to go on, like life insurance, health insurance, financial planning, it can all be done without somebody coming to your home.
Okay, now I'm very interested in that. First of all, is it a facial recognition kind of thing? Is it, I had Paul Ekman on the show, and we were talking about, you know, the different expressions we all have, and I was asking him, just because my husband's a plastic surgeon, I go, well, how does plastic surgery mess with what you're trying to do? And it, of course it does. And so if you're looking at certain things in your face, I guess this would not work really well in Beverly Hills or in Paradise Valley, Arizona, or in different areas.
Yeah,
right?
So it's interesting that you know about plastic surgery. That was one of the areas that we were disrupting. And part of the reason is that when patients go to your husband, it's pretty useful to know, to get some sense of what they're going to look like after the surgery is done.
Right.
And so that's exactly in part what this technology can do. And the irony there is that if you ask your husband, if you put two people or a dozen people in front of him, half of whom smoke and half of whom do not, with close to 100% accuracy, your husband is going to be able, just with his eyes,
right,
be able to determine which one is the smoker and which one isn't. And so what we've done at Lapidus is we've basically connected up somebody like your husband to a machine to find out exactly what part of the face his eyes are going to make the determination of whether or not they're a smoker or non-smoker.
That's cool.
And my colleague, Dr. Riksenik, has developed this technology to basically mimic what your husband is doing on a daily basis, which is to detect anomalies in the face. And it works. I mean, smoking writes a signature on your face that's absolutely unmistakable.
Right.
And your husband can see it, and will tell you.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I mean, he sees it. Mm-hmm. Exactly, those vertical lines on the upper lip, and there's other areas that are associated with smoking that can be differentiated from aging. So that's what we're doing at Lapidus, is we're using this technology to pick up on risk factors for diseases like smoking. You can actually calculate body mass index from a picture. So if somebody's being underwritten for life insurance and they're lying about their height and weight, guess what? The picture doesn't lie. Now, you asked about the folks in Beverly Hills that are using plastic surgery and other mm-hmm. Interventions, or people that try to manipulate pictures of themselves. You know what? We actually can't be fooled. Don't tell anyone.
Oh, you can tell if it's been
a radio program, but we cannot be fooled that easily.
That's funny. Well, you know, I'm curious about the BMI thing, because some people are really off from having a lot of muscle, aren't they?
Yes. So the irony is that the guy that I'm working with, Dr. Riksenik, is a former competitive weightlifter.
Mm-hmm.
So he is very acutely aware of the fact that you can have a large BMI and be mostly muscle.
Right.
So it is possible to generate a healthy BMI, or I can't remember what.
I'm curious what Schwarzenegger's is, you know, because his has got to be completely off, right?
Yeah, so there's a specific term for it where you can actually distinguish between BMI that's caused by fat and a high BMI that's caused by muscle. And so it is possible to tease that out. But now you're outside of my area of expertise.
But on your phone, if you can, instead of having them come take your blood and do all the invasive type of things that they do, are you able to take blood pressure and different things through your phone now? I mean, what can you exactly do that they need to do the review for life insurance?
Well, right now, the picture is not being used for the underwriting process.
Okay.
Of course, there's no detection of race at all. We're very careful to avoid that because that you can't do right. that during the life insurance underwriting process. So we avoid that completely. So the picture right now is being used only to detect fraud on whether or not somebody is lying about their smoking status and whether or not they might be lying about their height and weight. Somebody told me this morning that I think men overestimate their height by 2 inches and women overestimate their weight by 8 pounds or something like that.
Over you know, or underestimate on the weight?
No, you know what? If you show females a picture, you know, sort of these silhouettes of all the way from being underweight to being overweight, women tend to overestimate their image of themselves is to overestimate their weight by 1 or 2 standard deviations.
Huh, that's really interesting.
Yeah, it is, isn't it? It's been going on like that for a long time.
But, well, I think it's fascinating what you can pick up through some of the scanning. I've worked on a board here. It's a software that can recognize certain things about people as well, but it's not a facial recognition. Like you're saying, they're not picking out race. They're not picking out certain characteristics, but they're picking out things that are helpful for tracking. And you know that there's so much talk about what we want to have tracked. Do you think we're tracking too much? Do you worry about what you can track, or do you think that all this is more helpful than not?
Well, my personal view is that all of your information, all of your health information belongs to you. And you should be making the decision on what you reveal and what you don't. So at Lapidus, of course, we're very careful about letting anybody know what we do with photographs that come in. You know, we destroy data. But are people, revealing too much information about themselves? I don't really think so. And I actually think that this can be very useful in the future. I've actually published this a couple of years ago where I published an article in Computer where I talked about the rise of what I call a health data economy. Where basically, as you learn more and more about your own health status, and that includes, not just your blood chemistry, but your genetics, your behavioral habits, all of this information, while extremely valuable to you because it can help you guide your life to improve your health and quality of life, believe it or not, it's extremely valuable to merchants that want to sell you stuff.
Right.
For example, if your sleep pattern is off and you're not getting your needed 7 hours of sleep, you might get contacted by you might get an email from a company that sells mattresses. Or if your blood sugar is off, you might get, it should be your choice on whether you make this information available.
Yeah.
And I think you should be able to sell it. I actually think because you own your own health data, it should be your option on whether you want to sell it. So if these companies want to send stuff to you, fine. I'll let you send stuff to me for a price.
But once you've sold it, it's out there, and who's going to keep that next people from selling it to somebody else? You know what I mean?
It should go out the identified.
Mm-hmm. I wonder how much blockchain will have anything to do with how they track all that. You know what I mean? I'm sure a lot. You know, it's interesting with HIPAA, and I'm sure you deal with HIPAA quite a bit in the medical, what you can share, what you can't share. With everybody, all the doctors doing all this through Zoom and different things, that wasn't exactly locked down as well as they'd hoped when everybody was trying to do, some of these, you're looking at patients through Zoom instead of in person type of things. That where is HIPAA in all of this? Are they adjusting to the technology, or do you have to adjust to meet them, I guess, right?
Yeah, so that's a good question. I don't know the answer to this one. I don't know, because you're right, telemedicine has now taken off in the COVID era.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if Zoom, there has to be some sort of HIPAA compliance associated with these interactions that are taking place between doctor and patient. I haven't done it yet, so I don't know what the experience is like. It's a good question, because clearly there has to be some security protecting this relationship between doctor and patient. I just don't know how well they've they've adapted to this new world.
Well, you know, it's interesting because you pick up a prescription at the pharmacy and people are saying everything that's wrong with them right in front of you as loud as or in the line, and yet you have to be super careful somewhere else. And I think that all of it could probably use a little tweaking and help in some respects. But I think what you're working on is fascinating, and I'm curious if you're going to write any more books about what you're working on, or because you've written, as I mentioned, or edited certain ones. Is there anything on the docket for the future?
Yes. So here's the irony: in the last 3 months, I've written 2 books. Now, how does that even happen? So one of them is now published. It just came out a few weeks ago. It's called The Rise of Generians, How Science is Revolutionizing Life Industries. And it's generians, by the way, are people over the age of 70, right? Septuagenarians, octogenarians, nonagenarians. So it's the rise of this population and what it all means. And that's available on Amazon. And then I'm just now finishing another book called Pursuing Wealth Span, which is this effort by, the combined effort of Lapidus and Wealth Span Advisors to really change the financial services industry using science, aging science. And that's probably going to come out in the next 3 to 4 weeks as well. So yeah, there's a lot going on, and I don't know why I'm so productive at the moment, but it's been one of the most productive times I've ever had.
You can't go anywhere. You got to write. I mean, there's nothing.
That's it. I'm not traveling.
That could be it. But you do a lot of board work, and I'm curious. Now, didn't you serve on a board like at Pepsi in different places?
Scientific advisory board at PepsiCo. And, I'm on the board of American Federation for Aging Research. I'm on the board of a couple of other organizations. So there's a lot of board work that I'm doing. The fact is that the older population across the globe is rising dramatically. And this population is extraordinarily valuable. There's a lot of money pent up in the aging baby boomers, and where it's all going to go and how it's all going to be spent and transferred to subsequent generations. So there's a lot of interest. I mean, PepsiCo was interested in developing and marketing new products to help encourage healthy aging, which I was very much in favor of. So, I was very impressed by what PepsiCo was doing.
And what kind of things do they ask you for help? I mean, how can you help companies? I mean, what kind of input do you give?
Well, for example, the Social Security Administration, when I was advising them, or even the World Health Organization, that was all a focus on how much higher life expectancy can rise, because, even small changes in life expectancy produce large differences in the expected number of people to make it to older ages. So really, those were more technical in form, what assumptions should be made, what assumptions should we be avoiding. American Federation for Aging Research, well, our focus there is on trying to find a way to slow the biological process of aging. So there my focus is on helping explain what happens when we succeed. What are the consequences going to be if we can slow biological aging? What does it mean to us on a daily level, how we live our lives and how we plan for the future? PepsiCo, it's basically learning about the unique dietary needs and requirements of people that make it out to older ages and what would be most useful for helping them survive healthy to later ages. If there's something I don't know, like a specific, type of nutrient that's required to help individuals survive healthier to older ages, we bring in experts that have that expertise. So it's really just knowing the basics of human aging and longevity and then taking off from there and applying it to different industries.
Well, and as I mentioned, you do work as a professor of different things, and I was looking at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. Now,
yes.
What is tropical medicine?
Well, so years ago, and I probably didn't mention this, but I have published extensively on the rise and the reemergence of infectious and parasitic diseases. That's the tropical medicine part.
Oh, okay.
And so the COVID pandemic is something that is not unpredictable. We published a piece in the Population Bulletin back in 1997 describing basically exactly the phenomenon that we are now going through, predicting that we would have three pandemics in the 21st century. Of course, we didn't know exactly when it was going to happen, but we had, look, we had three pandemics in the 20th century, 1918, 1957, and 1968. There will likely be three pandemics in this century. We're in the middle of one right now. So this is not unexpected, and that's really the work that I did back in the latter part of the 20th century, was focusing in on what the likelihood was that we would have a pandemic, what the consequences would be if we did so. And by the way, one of the main predictions that we made back in 97 in that article was that some of the worst problems we would see would be in nursing homes and prisons, where you get people concentrated together in small areas where the spread of these diseases can occur very easily and very rapidly. And then, of course, the introduction of plane travel makes it possible to transport these microbes across the globe in a matter of hours.
Well, and you made your predictions, and I know, of course, the Bill Gates prediction of his talk. Why do you, I mean, he would obviously have a very big audience from people following him. Why do you think we don't heed what we hear in terms of these predictions, make plans for change?
Look, the 57 and the 68 influenza pandemics were not nearly as bad as the 1918 one and the one that we see here. So basically, we don't react until it's in our face.
Right.
We started spending less money on emergency preparedness for pandemics with the latest administration. So it's been a real problem. I can assure you, going forward, we will be planning for the next pandemic. There will be a surge protection. I mean, that you're going to see Dr. Fauci and Dr. Birx advocating, and I'm pretty sure that we are going to work very hard. And look, there may be a second and a third wave associated with this pandemic. We saw it in 1918, which began, I think, the last week in September, might have been early October, and it lasted until mid-November. And that second wave, just so you know, was, I think, somewhere between 5 to 10 times worse than the first wave. And then there was a third wave that happened in the spring of the following year. So these are things that we need to be concerned about today. And, people have not heeded this because it hasn't been in our face. Well, it's in our face now. And you've got a whole generation now that's going to grow up remembering COVID.
Right.
And so we will now be alerted to this for the rest of this century. We will not be surprised by this again.
It's interesting because my father ended up blind from that 1919, what you're talking about with the Spanish flu. And my grandmother had been pregnant with him at that time. And, I never really, it was not something that even I, having a father that way, was something anybody even talked about. Do you think this will be played down to a point eventually we get over it and we just go on? Or do you think this will have more of a lasting impact due to social media and everything else?
Yeah, good question. So, it's interesting that you would ask it that way because, polio used to be an absolutely devastating disease. And then the polio vaccine came around, and we became, complacent. Mm-hmm. Nobody really thinks about it because it's not in our face anymore. The same thing with measles and mumps and rubella. Remember, we developed vaccines, so now they're not in our face because we have these vaccines. So is it likely that we're going to see a vaccine for COVID? I certainly hope so. I saw a story just recently from Dr. Fauci, who was arguing that he thinks we're going to have a vaccine by the end of this year, early next year, and I'm hopeful. And then when that happens, I don't know if you're old enough to remember the time period when we got our sugar cubes with the polio vaccine.
I don't know if I remember it, or I do know what you're talking about, though.
So I went through that, and I remember it was a big deal. We all went to the school. You know, the parents rounded up all the kids, and everybody got their polio vaccine, and suddenly polio became a thing of the past.
Right.
So will we become complacent to COVID? Probably. If there's a vaccine, we will, you know, life will probably return back to normal. We will, you know, we won't be wearing masks. We will be shaking hands. We will be hugging our kids and our grandkids. And that, you know, life will go back likely to where it was if we are successful in developing either a vaccine or a treatment. If we don't develop a vaccine or an effective treatment, life will not go back to normal for years.
Well, I think what's normal is really interesting. As a pharmaceutical rep for 15 years, I shook everybody's hands, opened all the doors that everybody had been touching after coughing, and who knows what I touched, right? You know, I never thought about it. Ended up getting meningitis later, and that changes you forever for how much, what you think about, you know, of what you touch. And I wonder how much people will be like the same as they were if we will still shake hands. I'd kind of like to get rid of the handshaking thing. Do you think it'll come back?
I think it'll come back. I'm optimistic that we're going to have a vaccine, and once this is behind us, it will fade, very much like many other bad memories fade, and we will go back to going to restaurants and doing the things that we did before. That's my hope.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know for sure that that's going to happen, but I'm optimistic. I have been following the vaccine research that's been going on, so I'm optimistic that one of the vaccines, perhaps the one at Oxford or the one that's being tested here that's moved into phase three just recently, hopefully this is going to lead to a, you know, a viable vaccine that's going to work. And it will fade, and our memories will fade, and I think we're going to go back to handshaking and hugging, and I certainly hope we get back to hugging because I miss hugging my children and my grandson.
Well, as you're talking about these choices of, you know, I know AstraZeneca has been in the news, and we talked a little before the air that I'd worked for them for close to 20 years. And I remember they had a product that worked on keeping angiotensin 1 from turning into angiotensin 2. And then I read somewhere that they were looking at angiotensin as part of this, which is part of a process that happens in the kidneys. Is that how they're working on this? Is it like a blocker of sorts of...
I don't know. I don't know the mechanics of how these particular, I don't know, you know, each one of these efforts to create a virus, mm-hmm. many of them are pursuing different pathways to block,
mm-hmm.
You know, to block the virus.
Right.
So, and I don't know enough about the various pathways that they're pursuing, but I'm pretty sure the AstraZeneca approach is different than the one at Oxford. And what's interesting about this, by the way, and you've never seen this before, is they're already manufacturing massive doses of both.
Yeah, that is interesting. They're just going to take a bet, and if it doesn't work, they'll just have to do what?
It's the smartest thing to do. I mean, look, if you get this into the marketplace as quick as possible, the last thing you want to have is a choke point of not having enough of the vaccine. So they're you know, they're taking a fly on this, and I think it's the right thing to do. It's a smart approach to take, because if one of them works, they're going to, you know, they'll first give it to the first responders and the nurses and the doctors and everyone that's on the front line. But it should get, and then it'll go to people over 65 or 70 very quickly, and then it'll disseminate to the rest of the population, and this will be a bad memory.
You know, I read
you
that
and
like
40%, you know, hopefully,
won't take it.
Hopefully next year you and I will be talking again about, hey, you remember COVID?
Remember that? Yeah, unfortunately.
Hopefully it's over. We'll say, no, I forgot.
I forgot. But, you know, I did. I think I was listening. It was like 40% of people wouldn't even want to take it, or they weren't sure if they wanted to take it. And I'd have to give, I can't be positive that's the exact percentage, but it was pretty high.
Yeah, well, that would be consistent with the influenza vaccine that we have every year, because mm-hmm. the adult use of the or uptake of the influenza vaccine every year is about, I think it's about 46%. So that's terrible.
Mm-hmm.
And this coming year, hopefully it's going to get up above 90%, because that's part of what's going to contribute to the second wave, is the combination of influenza coming back, and we don't know which strain it's going to be, and mixed with COVID. So hopefully we're going to see a pretty large increase in the proportion of adult population that's going to get, the influenza vaccine.
What do you think of doing the herd mentality thing, where you just let people get it and have it be over?
Well, if you like the idea of having a lot of people die all at once, it's a great idea.
So obviously, you think we've done it the right way, then?
Yeah, okay. I mean, clearly, flattening the curve is not the same as eliminating the curve.
Uh-huh, right.
Flattening the curve just means you're extending it out for a longer time period, but you're reducing a peak. And the problem with the peak is it overwhelms the healthcare system.
Right.
And that's when you get a lot of deaths.
Right.
Occurring, and that's exactly what happened in New York City and some other places like Italy and elsewhere. And so you flatten the curve, you extend it out for a longer time period, and of course, the longer you wait, the better off you are, because we're learning a whole lot now about how to treat people that have the virus. They've gotten much better at treating the symptoms associated with it. So the longer you wait, the better off you are.
Well, it has been a really trying time, and I know you've written a lot about different things, and I loved your Wall Street Journal article. That was really it was a great big piece on you. You've gotten a lot of attention for your work. I'm curious, with all the things that you've been in, and Wall Street Journal is obviously very prestigious, how was it getting on 60 Minutes? Was that something that, did they want to talk more about, did they want somebody that kind of was a opposite to the DeGray viewpoint,
yeah,
or did they talk to you first, or how did that come to be, and what was that like being on 60 Minutes? I'm just curious.
Well, it was a lot of fun. First of all, Morley Safer was a real character. I'll tell you an interesting story. So I flew to New York for that, and I think I did the interview at the New York Academy of Sciences, and we had the whole building to ourselves, and he's sitting right in front of me. We're sitting on these stools, and he hands me a bottle of water, and I start to drink. And as soon as I start to drink the bottle of water, he asks me the first question. So I start coughing, and I said, "Why did you do that?" Apparently, he does that all the time.
He did that all the time. Oh, that's funny.
He's since passed away, but
I know.
That was a fascinating interview. And I don't know who they interviewed first, if it was Aubrey or me. My guess is it was Aubrey, because they were asking me some very specific questions about Aubrey's view. And, the debate between Aubrey and I is more for fun than anything else.
Because
I don't take it seriously. Aubrey's a good friend of mine.
Oh, really? Uh-huh.
He's a very good friend. Uh-huh. And, we openly disagree on this topic, and that's okay in the world of science to openly disagree. There's a lot of good things that Aubrey is advocating. Both of us completely agree that attacking aging is the way to go in the world of public health in the future. And it's the consequence of succeeding where we differ. But going after aging as a primary risk factor, we are absolutely in 100% agreement on. So are Steve Austin and I, my colleague that who participated in the debate in the Wall Street Journal. We're all in agreement that attacking aging is the way to go in the future, and we're very optimistic that this is going to succeed. So we will come up with something that you and I will be taking at some point that will lower the risk of heart disease, cancer, stroke, Alzheimer's, all the things that we don't like about growing older. It's going to make our biological clock tick at a slower rate, and hopefully we will remain healthier longer as a result. So the debate itself, I took with a grain of salt. They were looking for somebody to counter Aubrey's, shall we say, overly exaggerated comments about how long we're going to live.
Well, I thought it was a really interesting piece, and I think you guys did a nice job of balancing each other out on the whole thing, and I can't think of a better place to end this. And I think that a lot of people want to know more about how they can find your books or read about what you're doing to learn more about your company. How can they follow you or reach you?
Well, I can always be reached by email through my university email address. That's always a good start. It's sjayo@uic.edu. They can go out to Amazon and look up my name, and they could look up The Rise of Generians. They could look up Aging, the Longevity Dividend, The Quest for Immortality. The book that I published called A Measured Breath of Life is an ebook. Or they could check out the stuff that I have a website called sjolshansky.com. Mm-hmm.
Well,
you really want to check out some of the stuff that I've done, and you can download many of the articles and whatnot, go to sjolshansky.com, and or just send me an email, or you can go to laughatasolutions.com and pick up what we're doing there. I'm easy to get a hold of.
Well, this has been really great, Jay. Thank you so much for sharing so much great information. I really enjoyed this.
Yeah, my pleasure. Great question.
Oh, thanks. And we will be back right after this message.
Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate.
Well, I really want to thank Jay for being my guest today. We get so many great guests on this show. If you've missed any past episodes, you can catch up with them on drdianehamilton.com. There's a lot of people that I've interviewed, and I know that there's so many great guests, and I hope you take some time to explore the site. You can also find out about Curiosity Code Index training or the Cracking the Curiosity Code book. Everything's on my site. So go to drdianehamilton.com and you can find out more. And I hope you enjoyed today's episode, and I hope you enjoy the next episode of Take the Lead Radio. You've been listening to Take the Lead with Dr. Diane Hamilton on C-Suite Radio.